welcome to Coffee with Coker, a healthcare business podcast from the Coker Group that focuses on solutions to help healthcare organizations effectively navigate the changing healthcare industry. My name's Mark Reibolt. I'm a senior vice president at Coker, and I'm the host of the podcast. And we're excited to have another episode today, again, talking about healthcare technology. And we've talked about healthcare technology a couple of times on past episodes. And obviously, it's going to be something we talk about more in the future because it's a significant part to what Coker does in our services and how we work with our clients. And so healthcare IT being such a large kind of broad issue, there's a lot going on there. And I was excited for this episode to talk with Terry Wilk, who's a senior vice president here at Coker. And Terry brings a lot of extremely valuable experience and background, specifically around healthcare technology. He has served multiple times as a CIO in a hospital or health system and over the years, and has years of experience dealing with the issues that executives and senior management teams within hospitals deal with as it relates to technology. And that's exactly what we're talking about today. So the specific focus of our discussion today is the five questions that Astute boards are asking about healthcare IT. And really what this ties into is it's not just boards. Obviously, boards of a hospital or health system need to be aware of these kind of issues, but it applies to the C-suite, to senior management teams, to even middle management teams, and how hospitals and health systems are confronting the changing and very dynamic landscape as it relates to technology. It also is not just hospitals, but your large medical groups. They're all confronting issues around technology. And so that's what we're talking about today, applies directly to that. So we talk a little bit about not only what are the five key questions, but really boils down to the business issues that senior teams are having to face today as it relates to IT. We talk a lot about the fact that, you know, it's not just about software here. We're talking about data and analytics. We're talking about cybersecurity. And we're talking about the financial impact, positive or negative, that technology can have on these types of organizations. We're also talking about how things like consolidation and other unique characteristics going on in the marketplace today ultimately tie into technology and how technology is relevant to those things going on. So these are, it's not just a technical discussion by any means. In fact, it is much more a broader discussion around strategic planning, operations and management, and financial management as well. So it's a great discussion. I hope you enjoy it. I want to remind you all to subscribe so that you can hear more episodes like this and similar topics. And so you can also listen to not only this episode, but all of our episodes on our website. And you can find the podcast episodes at coffeewithcoker.com. Or you can go to CokerGroup.com and you can find us there as well and access all the episodes that we've done thus far, as well as any supporting material, articles, white papers, things like that that we've published on these topics. And then finally, I just want to encourage everyone, if you have questions or you'd like to send feedback, please do so. You can reach us directly at feedback@cokergroup.com, or again, you can go through that coffeewithcoker.com website and access a feedback page there as well. But we love to hear your questions, or if you just have comments, if you want to dig into issues more, we will respond to them and we will address those, any questions or follow-on comments. We love to get that. And if there's something you'd like to hear more about on a future episode, please feel free to send us those recommendations as well. Because again, we will respond to them if it's important to you guys and it's relevant to what we're all collectively doing in this marketplace, then we want to make sure it's on our radar to ensure that we address that in the future. So again, thank you for listening. We hope you enjoy and we'll see you on the next episode. All right. Well, we are here as we mentioned in the intro, with a new guest, the first time on the podcast. So welcome, Terry Wilk.
Thank you, Mark.
Yeah, glad to have you on, Terry. You know, it's interesting, again, as we alluded to in the intro, what we're talking about today relates to healthcare IT, and Terry obviously has a lot of experience as it relates to healthcare IT, both on the health system side and then, of course, on the consulting side. But he's a senior VP in our healthcare technology consulting practice. And one of the things Terry works on a lot is, you know, working with boards. And he's been in a, I guess, a CIO role before, right? Yeah, multiple times. And so this is nothing new to Terry, but I'm sure the challenges, even though there are a lot of them and they're probably some of the same ones, they also continue to evolve. So again, as we mentioned, we're talking about working with executives and specifically five questions that astute boards ask about healthcare IT. So I think it's a great discussion. And I guess, Terry, maybe since this is your first time, as we're jumping in, just give us, you know, quick 20-second background on you and kind of some of that experience to put it in context a little bit.
Yes, sure, Mark. Thank you. I've been in the healthcare industry a little over 40 years, 20 of those years or half the time as a CIO in four different health systems. I have really focused on working and partnering with executives and physicians and how we can use IT more effectively to achieve the organization's goals, looking at certainly developing a strategic plan for IT, funding the IT plan, laying out a timeline, working collaboratively with a number of different people, stakeholders, as we call them, and looking at the, as many people in the audience probably have heard before, the people, process, technology triad, if you will, mm-hmm. and how we can really operationalize that and make that, get some real value out of putting those pieces together. And a lot of that involves evaluating and implementing different IT systems and really using IT effectively to achieve goals and objectives.
Yeah. Well, that, of course, ties into what we're talking about today. So as we boil this down for this discussion, which, again, mentioned this in the intro, but this discussion plays off a white paper that you've written recently and that is out there and will be made available with this episode as well on this topic. But I like boiling things down like this to, in this case, five questions, but specifically five questions. And we get a lot of feedback, whether it's a board or it's management team at a hospital or a health system or a physician group, whatever that may be. But, you know, IT is obviously a continuous challenge or thing that has to be dealt with. Before, though, we get into those five questions, talk for a minute about why should leaders be asking these questions as it relates to health IT?
Well, I think, Mark, first of all, if we go back to why a board exists, a board, of course, provides governance at the highest level to oversee this different strategies, the operations of the organization, the business aspect of it, quality, the HR issues, legal issues, risks, and IT as well, because IT really touches all of those. And mm-hmm. as we all know, IT is very expensive. And if we don't do IT right and well, it can really harm the organization. And if it's severe enough, it can impact an organization and drive them out of business.
Yeah.
I mean, that's what I've seen over my 40 years of the risk aspect and the cost aspect of it.
I think it's interesting that we do. It is easy sometimes to fall in the trap of looking at technology on a kind of mutually exclusive basis, kind of on its own silo, if you will. But there's really no way to look at the operations, the finances, personnel, whatever it may be, without incorporating some technology into that. And there's no way to look at technology without understanding all those other components.
Correct.
As well.
Yeah. Great points. I think too, Mark, that as leaders, executives and boards, they really need to understand their role in governing IT based on really the business implications of its IT investments. In other words, why do we want to automate something? Why do we want to put an IT system in place? Just because somebody else has it, or because we're really trying to solve a problem or differentiate ourselves using the technology. Mm-hmm. Secondly, I think it's important for executives and boards to ask the right questions and knowing what questions to ask about IT. Many people, particularly at the executive and board levels, I found, are not that comfortable dealing with IT. They don't know the questions to ask. It's just kind of out of their realm. They see IT as a big black box. They don't understand it, and consequently, they kind of avoid it. They're more comfortable talking about finance, physician relationships, quality, you know, some of those aspects, maybe evaluating joint ventures and all of that. But IT seems to take a back seat.
I think that's an interesting point, because there are a lot of times I feel like where the management teams, leadership, boards, whatever it may be, actually bypass that whole step of asking, why are we doing this? Why are we allocating $100 million over the next 5 years to implement this system? Well, it's because the vendor said that's what you needed. Is it because, you know, our CIO really believes it? Is it, or, you know, is it something in the market that's going on, like you said, because others have it, or it's the shiniest new thing, or what? I mean, and sometimes when you drill down, I would imagine when you really drill down into the why, you probably would get some interesting answers if people were being honest about it.
That's right. I think another reason we need to pay attention to IT is there's enough examples in the marketplace of failure. Mm. There's a high consequence of failure, not only financially, but in the public. You know, people aware of, boy, this organization failed, or their days in AR went from 60 to 180.
Or data breaches.
Exactly.
That get out into the news, things like that. Yeah.
Yeah. Excellent point. So that's why I think some of the reasons why executives and boards need to pay attention to it, and some of the key business issues that are impacting organizations as well, as I mentioned, the high cost, capital and operating cost, major, major effort on IT system implementations. It's like doing surgery on yourself. You're running a race, you're an athlete, and you have to do heart surgery and maybe brain surgery at the same time, and you don't have the ability to take the organization and put it in bed or shut it down for 6 months or a year while you do this major surgery. You got to do it while you're running the race, while you're going 100 miles an hour down the highway. How do you change out the engine or repair the wheels, the tires? I mean, it's things like that. High risk, a lot of effort in the organization. There's emerging technologies coming out. Are we implementing something that's going to be outdated in 2 years? Those are issues I think executives and boards need to deal with. There's all the compliance issues. And Mark, you had mentioned security and compliance with HIPAA, those kinds of things, and privacy. And of course, the business continuity and recovery aspect. Fortunately, we don't hear a lot about organizations losing all their data and they can't function. It does happen, but that's another aspect and reason why executives and boards need to pay attention to this.
Yeah. Yeah. On the security or the compliance side, I know another thing that you do, and I think we'll talk about this more probably in future episodes, and we have information out there that we published in the past on this, but is cybersecurity. And obviously that ties into compliance. But I know that's something you spend a good bit of time on yourself, right?
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah,
absolutely.
So I would imagine these are major surprises, but to a lot of, you know, whether it's a management team or anything like that. But the rate at which technology is changing and evolving, and the impact on the healthcare delivery process and those organizations, it's gotten to that point where I remember, you know, a number of years ago where, for instance, EHRs, it was a decision do or not do type thing. Now that's not the case. It is. Yes, obviously we have to do, but, you know, let's now figure out how to do in the most efficient, effective, cost, you know, value-oriented manner.
That's right. And as I interact with clients, a lot of the times where we are called in, or I'm called in to talk to somebody, it's, boy, we spent all this money. We don't think we're getting the value out of it. Or our physicians are complaining.
Sure.
I mean, nobody's happy with it. And can you help us understand why? And when you drill down, there's a couple of basic fundamental reasons that I would say from my experience, both as a CIO and now as a consultant. One is people didn't understand what they were getting into to begin with. They didn't understand the extent of change that needed to happen at the people, process and technology dimensions. Mm-hmm. And then there's the cultural aspect. And this leads into some of the five questions we'll talk about in a little bit. And that is, how do I view IT? Is it a necessary evil? Is it just a utility like our electricity is? You turn a light switch on, light comes on, you don't even think about it. Or is it potentially a strategic enabler? And there's a lot of people that talk about that, but in terms of really operationalizing and using IT in a wise way and getting buy-in to get people to use it and understand it in a strategic way to be to differentiate yourself and be better.
Yeah, yeah. Well, that point about they didn't know what they were getting into, I think is interesting, and there were probably you could take that even a couple different directions, but I can definitely see it's become one of those things. Executives may look at and they will all day long acknowledge, yes, we got to have it. We need to do it. All right, we're going to allocate the budget, you know, the resources and funding that needs to go. But what it really means at a granular level of implementation and change management and mm-hmm. process design or perhaps redesign, the impact on personnel, that's hard to even conceptualize unless you've gone through it. Or, you know, that until you actually get into it, and which I think is an interesting because you coming from a CIO background, you've been through those scenarios before. You know, I'm sure that there's still a lot of CIOs out there that are very shocked once they when they realize what all this entails once they get into the process.
Sure. And I can attest too. Fortunately, it hasn't happened to me. But if there's CIOs listening to this podcast, CIO, we think, stands for Chief Information Officer. It really stands for career is over if we're not careful in how we do things.
Well, that's that's a scary thought. But that's maybe we need to move to CTO and see what kind of funny acronym we can tag onto that. Well, let's dive into the questions then. And I know in reviewing the white paper, the first one talks about something that I do a lot of work with myself, not in terms of technology, as it were, but understanding the strategic importance. So maybe talk about that as we dive into those questions.
Sure. Let me just highlight real quick the five questions that think are, and they're just, these aren't just the five. These aren't the top five necessarily. They are five that I'm finding more and more interest in from board members and executives when we talk. One is, what is the strategic importance of IT to the organization? What is the strategic importance of IT to the organization? Two, what role should executives and board have in governing the IT assets? Now, IT assets, let me define that. When I, and you'll see in the white paper, talk about IT assets, I'm talking about data, information, technology, people. Those kinds of things coming together and need to be governed, just like buildings, just like money, and so on. Thirdly, what competencies do executives and boards need to govern IT effectively? You've got to understand, have some level of competency in finance or HR or legal if you're going to govern it. Same thing with IT. Fourth question, how and when are matters related to IT reported to the board? We'll get into that a little bit later. And then five, how should the board leverage IT to improve its value to the organization? The board itself now, not IT, but the board, obviously a governing entity, it can add value. Typically, they're business leaders or other types of leaders with experience in different industries that can bring knowledge back to the hospital or the physician group or whatever healthcare organization they're a board of to be able to add value to the organization from the board level. Same thing with the executives, too. They need to have a good, strong competency as well.
Dive in a little bit further on, and we don't have to go through each one necessarily because I know you do go into a lot more detail in the white paper, but walk us through maybe understanding the strategic importance, I guess, to start with. Because I look at strategy from another angle, usually it's related to transactions, right? Organizations considering some sort of merger or acquisition. And I say the exact same thing. Before you do anything related to a transaction, you need to first validate the strategic rationale behind why you're doing it. And then should you do it? And then you can think about how and how much and all that stuff. But maybe talk about that as it relates to technology.
Okay. Regarding the strategic importance, I come back to what I said a little earlier. the organization, it's important for the organization to understand its perspective on the role that IT plays. Is it a necessary evil that I mentioned that's you kind of grin and painfully bear it? Is it an invisible utility? In other words, its operating reliability is the main focus to maintain the status quo, or is it an enabler of strategic and competitive differentiation? Transform processes, make the organization be more customer-centric, customer-focused, having more real-time access to what customers are saying on their patient surveys, even when they're in the house, feedback that you may get. Once an organization kind of decides the strategic importance of it, then I think they can be in a better position to determine what role their IT assets should play. If it's simply a utility, maybe we don't want to be on the leading edge of emerging technologies, for example, Mark.
Good point. Yeah. No, I think that's a good point because a lot of times when we hear technology, we automatically assume we have to be on the leading edge and we have to get the shiniest new thing and the best and the most expensive and et cetera. And sometimes if you look at your strategic rationale for doing whatever you're doing, then that may not be the best solution, honestly.
Right. The other thing that's interesting, when we look at companies like Amazon and eBay and Apple, I mean, they are all about focusing on customers and really giving an ultra convenient experience. I mean, all of us to one degree or another are a customer of Amazon, eBay, certainly Apple, iPhones, smartphones. Mm-hmm. And what that gets me to think about and talk to some of our people that interact with customers and prospects and so on is, how will IT change the basis of competition in the healthcare industry and in our market? Look at what your competitors are doing. You know, I'm finding in some areas of the country, some markets, there's the leaders in IT. They're the first adopters. They're on the very bleeding edge. Sure, they're going to make mistakes, but not everybody has the money and the time to be able to take some chances like it. So you need to understand, to come back to the strategic importance of IT. How do we view it? What's happening in our marketplace? And how will it change the basis of competition? And really, Amazon, eBay, and Apple, they're really in a quote-unquote digital arms race when you think about it.
Yeah.
One gets something and then the other one bypasses it and it keeps going. And it'll be interesting to see where we go. And they're really trying to do that to differentiate themselves through IT-enabled convenience and service.
Yeah.
What can we do to bring that to healthcare?
We've talked about this before on the podcast and talking about value-based care, population health, consumer-driven healthcare. It's a factor, and technology is definitely can be an enabler to allow greater service quality, efficiency, timeliness, those types of things. And I think, well, I'd be curious. This is a little bit of a tangent here, but I'm just curious to get your observation on this. Do you feel like looking at any given market, and you come across those organizations that are on the leading edge, and I'm talking more about you go into a local market and you have your health systems there, let's say, do you think if you can pinpoint those players in that specific market that are the leading edge as it relates to their optimization of technology, do you think that directly correlates to value, or how is that trickle down and kind of show some sort of results in a competitive landscape? Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. Great question. As I think about that, you know, I would say, one would think that the larger hospitals or health systems would be on that leading, bleeding edge, and a number of them are for sure. But what I see, Mark, is the number one factor, whether it's a large, small, medium-sized critical access hospital, sure, for example, or, 20, 30 hospital system, is the perspective of leadership on IT. Coming back to what's the strategic importance? I've been surprised at some organizations that you would think, boy, they ought to really be ahead and be very efficient, have their better revenue cycle metrics, quality metrics, and they don't because they don't have the culture. The culture hasn't been developed. The expectation and accountability has not been put in place to use IT. Mm-hmm. And I'm talking at the board level and the executive level. Smaller organizations, I've seen amazing things, for example, because the leadership gets it. The leadership adopts it. The leadership enforces it. And it's a learning. It's a journey, not a destination, to use a common phrase.
Yeah, absolutely. That makes tons of sense. I have to believe, too, there's the other side of that coin. And I can think of a couple of clients I've worked with where they are killing it as it relates to growth, value, revenue, you know, those types of metrics. But you look at them in terms of what they're doing from a technology management innovation standpoint, and you're amazed for a minute there to even think that an organization could almost, despite themselves as it relates to their technology decisions, still be so successful. And I guess there's some degree of disconnect or lack of correlation there as it relates to innovation still maybe in the market.
Yeah, it does. I think that's a good point. But one thing's for sure that I've seen, organizations that are more successful and being able to demonstrate it on the revenue cycle side, the quality of care side, the patient satisfaction side, getting more of a return from on their value-based contracts as they move into that, definitely have IT deployed very, very well. Their people trained, the integration is there, the security and confidentiality is there. They've got good pieces. It doesn't mean they're perfect or that they've arrived.
Yeah.
But clearly they've adopted and adapted IT within their organizations.
And I think the other takeaway there, and again, this is just my observation, I have to think, though, is that the failure to do that is not sustainable, or that growth that they have achieved despite their failure to adapt and adopt technology in an efficient manner, it's not going to be there forever, or at least they can't assume it's going to be there forever. So it's one thing to have some success that just comes because of, you know, external market dynamics. But when you start really getting into competitive landscape, that's where the edge, I think you could find the competitive edge there.
That's right. That's right. There's more and more examples of that happening.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yep. When you talk about the other key question, you talk about executives, what role executives and boards should have in terms of governing IT assets. You made an important distinction there that was interesting to me and didn't jump out to me before, but essentially the way I interpret it is that when you talk about those assets, it's not just a software solution, if you will. It's not just an EHR, for instance. There's a lot more to it. Can you maybe speak to that a little bit further?
Sure. And that goes back to, again, the assets that as I defined it,
right.
the people, the technology, really the knowledge of how to use the technology. It's one thing to have the tools. It's another thing to have the knowledge to know how to use them and when to use them. For example, a very simple example, carpentry. You could use a hammer and a nail and a manual saw, or you could use a table saw and a pneumatic nailer. And knowing first of all, those tools are available.
Mm-hmm.
Number two, how to use those tools safely and correctly, and which tool is appropriate for the right task that you have to build something or fix something. So I think, you know, the more that I interact with executives and board members and leading physicians as well, physician leaders, is getting them to see the broader picture. As you just said, Mark, in a beautiful way, there's many, many more components than just the technology component, hardware or software.
That's right. And you made that point well, because at the end of the day, I like your carpentry analogy there, but you know, I can outfit my garage with the greatest tools in the world. Mm-hmm. Doesn't mean you want me building a piece of furniture for you or anything. But I've seen that time after time here, and with organizations of all sizes, where it's like, okay, we wrote the check, everything should be, this is kind of our silver bullet here, everything should be resolved, and then a couple days later, or even a couple months later, when that hasn't happened yet, then it's like, oh, well, this isn't working for us. Something, you know, we made a bad decision. And it's like, well, no, maybe you just didn't follow through on what I think is probably the hardest part. And that is the people and the processes, I think.
Yeah, absolutely. And coming back to the what role executives and boards should have, if you really think about it, Gartner Group has this on their website. It's a very good descriptor. But in summary, there's really kind of three dimensions that boards and executives need to keep in mind when governing assets. One is, how do we make sure that what we have or what we plan to have is going to have an effective and efficient use of enabling the organization to achieve its objectives. So it's the usefulness of it. Is it really effective and efficient? Secondly, is the demand governance, which means as IT permeates the organization, as you were describing earlier, how do we manage the demands? Because clearly, I mean, literally every CIO and organization I've interacted with, and myself as well, have a much more of a huge backlog of requests and systems to put in than you're able to do.
Sure.
Even if you're blessed to have the money to hire outside staff. Thirdly is the supply side. So there's the demand, and then the supply side, well, yeah, you can hire somebody from the outside, but there's only so much change an organization can deal with at one time. But the outside staff itself, I think the board and the executives really need to take a hard look at evaluating their own IT organization. Do they have the right leader in place, CIO, for example? Do they have the right management team, the directors, managers? Are there processes of how they do things within IT efficient and effective as well? Are they customer-oriented? And if not, needing to fix that, particularly the executives. The board should be asking the difficult questions that the executives and particularly the CIO and other IT leaders would address.
Yeah. Skipping around a little bit or skipping ahead, again, in the white paper, you go into a lot more detail on each of these. But I wanted to jump to the point about improving value for an organization and how IT does that. Can you speak to that a little bit more? Because this is always something I hone in on just from, again, looking at value, whether it's from financial perspective or now, and you alluded to this earlier, if you're looking at more value-based care where there's truly, you know, value-based contracting, things like that. But help us understand a couple of ways perhaps where IT connects to that value piece.
Okay, sure. Great question. Let me use an analogy or another example, and then I'll answer your question. When I look at the CFOs I've worked with, for example, in an organization, if an organization is doing poorly financially, at some point, typically the CFO loses his or her job.
Yeah.
But I've come to realize, because in most cases, not all, but in most cases, the CFO is really a scorekeeper. He helps create a budget. He tracks the actual versus the budget. He's not responsible for operations. Mm-hmm. He's not responsible for the physician's pen in terms of what they order. But he or she is the scorekeeper primarily.
Yeah.
On the IT side, unfortunately, the CIO is responsible for making sure the right IT systems are in place, much like the CFO needs to ensure the right money is there and we're spending it correctly, all of that. Unfortunately, the CIO doesn't have the authority to tell nursing or lab or radiology, hey, we've just put this system in, you're not using it effectively. And if that department manager or VP doesn't have the right perspective on IT and doesn't recognize that or see that gap, the CIO is kind of left in the blank, in the middle, if you will. And so, as I said earlier, joked around, CIO's career is over. Unfortunately, I've seen a lot of CIOs lose their job for similar reasons the CFO has lost their job. You get fired, basically, or let go because you're not getting the results, the value that the organization is expecting, but there's only so much you can do. What I've seen organizations that have gotten good value out of their IT investment is, it comes back again, what is the board and the executive perspective is on IT? Mm. Number two, is the culture one of accountability? Mm. Do they hold people accountable? Yeah. Look, we just spent $400,000 or $4 million on this EMR or this new whiz-bang lab system you said we needed. Where's the benefit? So many years ago, we used to call, and maybe some organizations do it today, a make-good analysis. In other words, when you go to the board and you get approval for something, you come back in 6 months or a year to, quote unquote, make good. Give a report on, well, what happened? You told us as part of the investment proposal, we're going to do this, and here's what we should get out of it, and, well, did we? And a lot of organizations don't do that. But now that the cost of IT has gotten so higher and it's impacting so many things throughout the organization, I think astute boards and executives are beginning to ask those kinds of questions.
Yeah, sorry to interrupt you, but I mean, that's a natural kind of follow through towards accountability, or, you know, and that it's a little more subtle, meaning you don't have to, you know, drop the hammer on somebody when the results aren't there the next day or something like unreasonable like that. But there is that expectation that, okay, I have to answer for this decision or this recommendation. And so, you know, there has to be a system in place that, that allows us to follow through. And I have to have the level of authority and autonomy and access to resources in order to make this right or make it work and make good on it.
Yeah. That's absolutely right. And there's no one way to be able to prove the value that you're getting.
Sure.
I mean, the organization has to define what value means.
Yeah, that's right.
Is it we're getting our days in AR reduced? Is it we're increasing revenue? Are we expanding our business, adding clinics, ambulatory surgery centers? What role does IT play?
Maybe less complaints from the physician, yeah, medical staff, you know? Yeah. I mean,
And IT typically, it's hard to say, well, because we implemented this new revenue cycle module, or we revised how physicians order tests, for example, that yes, that's a direct correlation in terms of our revenue went up, our cost to collect went down, our physicians are more happy. It's usually blended in along with other factors.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, that's right. That's right. I think that's a huge point there, defining what value means for you. Again, that's, we do that with transactions, right? We say, yeah, what is your, you know, it's one thing to look at the kind of traditional ROI, and it's more of a financial discussion typically, but especially for hospitals, value, quote unquote, is can be interpreted and translated a lot of different ways. And you have to look at it beyond dollars and cents, because at the end of the day, there are a lot of organizations out there that make a lot of money, generate a lot of revenue, and exhibit a lot of growth. But then you can also find a number of those organizations where quality may be compromised, particularly as they get larger.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I think that's another interesting point here that I've seen because of our work as it relates to transactions and M&A deals and that type of activity over the years, particularly with the consolidation that's happened here in the last few years. You know, it used to be they didn't start talking about IT integration until the deal was pretty much done, right? Mm-hmm. Then it was kind of like, all right, now what are we going to do to get these, to figure out, you know, how we integrate, figure out what's even over there, you know? But now I'm seeing, and my recommendation is always, when we're involved in a deal process, you need to start planning for integration and understanding as a part of due diligence, not after the deal's done or after the dust settles, that type of thing.
Boy, you're right on. And as a practicing CIO for over 20 years, one of my top recommendations to a board or executive team is, as you're thinking about new business initiatives, mm-hmm, clinical initiatives, transactions like you're talking about, whatever it is, please include IT upfront. Now, obviously, they can't know all the confidential items, but at least give them a sense so they can begin planning now. Because the worst thing you could do,
drop it on them.
Exactly. Yeah. And then expect them to get something done in a month.
That's right.
Going to take 6 months or a year to plan.
Well, and it's so critical. We've seen that. I can tell you, I can go through transactions that we've done in the past and have followed them after the deal is done and directly correlate those organizations that could exhibit value from that deal or from that new initiative, like you're talking about, in the shortest period of time, are those that started that planning process way early on. And that always had to include IT, just like it would include personnel or you know, anything. Those that started planning earlier and earlier are the ones that ultimately generated value sooner and sooner.
You know, Mark, I'm working with a new client to Coker that very recently became part of our client base. And what you've just said is exactly what this organization has done. Mm. The CIO, the CFO, the board recognized we need to have IT involved up front. And I was thrilled to learn
that
when they brought us in.
Yeah.
And so that makes it a whole lot easier to interact, understand the issues, to then make sure we're on a timely basis addressing them.
Yeah. Well, kudos to them. That's great. Well, this has been extremely an interesting discussion. And again, I know there's a lot more kind of details that comes along with all these different points and different questions. And so a lot of that's covered again in your white paper. And I know we'll be talking about this more because I'm sure, as you said, these aren't all of the questions, not necessarily even the top questions, but this list of questions or these lists of components that need to be addressed, I'm sure continues to evolve, grow, change, and as the market changes. So I'm sure we'll be revisiting some of these. But, we appreciate you coming on and addressing these things, and we look forward to having you back and talking more about it.
Great, Mark. Thank you. I've enjoyed this as well.
We hope you enjoyed that episode of Coffee with Coker, and we thank you for listening. We want to encourage all of our listeners to participate and contribute in the podcast. So if you have any questions on any of the things we discussed in this episode, any of the topics that were presented, please feel free to ask us. Also, we welcome your feedback and suggestions. If you have any ideas related to the material we discussed in this episode, or in any episode, please let us know and we'll make sure to incorporate it. And if you have ideas for topics you'd like to hear more information about in future episodes, please send those suggestions to us. We'd love to hear them and we'd love to incorporate them into our future episodes. You can find us online and on social media. Start with our website, and specifically the podcast is coffeewithcoker.com. You can also find that through the main Coker website at cokergroup.com. You can also find us on social media, Twitter at Coker Group. And then on LinkedIn, you can search for Coker Group and find our page and the page for some of our team members as well there. So you can find us and reach out to us a number of places. And then if you want to contact us directly, one of the best ways to do that, email feedback@cokergroup.com. That's feedback@cokergroup.com. And again, we'd love to get your feedback. And we'd love to encourage everyone to subscribe to the podcast so that you can be notified when future episodes are released. We look forward to the next episode, and we look forward to getting your suggestions and feedback on this episode. Thanks for listening, and we look forward to speaking with you again on future episodes.